Good morning. I welcome you all as we gather on this third Sunday of Easter. We welcome those who are worshiping with us for the first time, either here in the sanctuary or online. As we share a few announcements, I invite those seated on the inside aisles to sign the friendship pads and to pass them along. And as always, we encourage you to greet one another warmly. Following the service, everyone is invited to join us in Fellowship Hall for coffee, conversation, and fellowship. Our Minister of Discipleship, Gail McLaughlin, is with our confirmation class at Aldersgate United Methodist Church. One Sunday during confirmation, they attend another church to see how other people of faith worship. And so we will look forward to her and their return next week. The flowers to my right are from a service that was held yesterday here in our sanctuary celebrating the life of Edna Smith, a longtime member who has been living in Florida for about the last 8 years. We have three announcements this morning. First one is from Nancy Thorne. I'll invite her forward. She has an announcement on behalf of the Faith Circle, and then Shelley Galati has one on behalf of Faith Fellowship, and Patrick Clerkin has one on behalf of the House Ministry.
Oh, wow. Good morning.
Good morning.
This week is our church spring rummage sale, sponsored by Faith Circle. We'll be accepting clothing and household items in good condition. A complete list of items that will not be accepted is in your Hilltop News, which includes electronic and computer items. We welcome and encourage anyone to come help these ladies during the weekday mornings. We get lots of donations that need to be unbagged and laid out on the tables. It's not hard work, but it's a lot. Someone is here from 8 to early afternoon on the weekdays, and any amount of time it can give us is gratefully accepted. And finally, I'm looking out, I'm scoping people, a reminder that we need some strong hands today to set up the tables in Fellowship Hall right after coffee hour. It normally takes only about a half an hour, maybe less. Thank you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
So the Faith and Fellowship Ministry is going to have a seminar today at 12 o'clock following the fellowship, and we're going to be having the seminar right outside of these folding doors. We'll be talking about cleaning and some cleaning tips as you're getting into the spring spirit. And so we'll be talking about organizing, purging, and we'll also be talking about some cleaning tips, and maybe more importantly, how to stay calm and keep perspective when things like this melt all over your yellow couch. And I speak from experience. So if you can join us, we'd love to have you. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
I don't have a name tag on, but I'm Patrick Clerkin. If you don't know me by now, I hope the main reason you know me isn't for occasionally missing one of these. More importantly, today I am the chair of the House Ministry, and recently we were putting together a capital improvements list for the church, and one of those improvements was a modernization of Fellowship Hall. And we had a bunch of sub-projects in mind for that, like changing the ceiling and the lighting fixtures, encapsulating the floor, and painting the wainscoting, the kitchen. There's a lot of projects in that room. And so we wanted to put together a subcommittee of people who are not only interested, but preferably have some more expertise, like some interior design expertise or maybe lighting expertise, things like that. This is really a preliminary phase right now, so we don't have a timeline established, but we just want to know who's interested and who has the some of the skill sets that we would need. And you can talk to me if you see me around. I can get my information out there through the Hilltop News in future weeks as well. So thank you. I appreciate it.
Are there any other announcements? Yes, David.
Morning, everyone.
Good morning.
It's tough to be asking for volunteers when you're the fourth one up here, but but I'll try to skip to the line next time. Again, my name is David Baker. I'm new to the Church Council, and the Church Council is creating a committee to create a new five-year strategic plan. The last one was done in 2017. We have several members now from the council, but we're looking for members at large from the congregation. We'd like to get the complete perspective of the church. We expect the time commitment to be approximately one meeting per month, and then maybe some work outside. No meetings in July or August. But my email address is in the Hilltop News, or you can come and see Laura Kaplan, Gary Hastings, or Dave McLaughlin, any of us, and we'd be happy to get you joined up. Thanks very much.
One of my favorite proverbs says that where there is no vision, the people perish. I like to reframe that in a more positive way and say that where there is a vision, the people prosper. And so we thank Council for spearheading this project. A couple of additional announcements. Reminder to all of our high school graduates who will be graduating in a couple of months that the Kenrick Scholarship is awarded each year on the basis of service to the church and community. There is a link and has been a link in the Hilltop News for the application form, and those are due by April 30th. Next Sunday, we're going to have an Ask the Pastor sermon. We haven't done that in a while, and I will do my best to answer any questions that you have about Scripture, about our faith in general, and there will be a link in the Hilltop News to submit questions. Then looking ahead, on May 7th, it will be a special Sunday for us. Both of our seminarians, we have two of them, Gail McLaughlin, who is attending Eden Seminary, which is based in St. Louis, she's attending virtually, and Oliver Mesmer, who is attending Andover Newton at Yale, will be here with us. They will be leading us in the sacrament of communion, and then following the service, everyone will be invited up to Fellowship Hall for a celebration, as both of them will be graduating in May, and we want to share the joy with them. Are there any other announcements? If not, then let us continue to celebrate the miracle of the empty tomb with our joyful alleluias. Please join me in the responsive call to worship. We come this day to walk with the risen Christ.
Come, Lord Jesus.
And walk with us as you did with the disciples on the road to Emmaus.
Come, Lord Jesus.
And open our hearts and minds to the grace and the truth of God's holy word.
Come, Lord Jesus.
And set our hearts on fire with the good news that because you live, we will live also.
Thank you.
join me in our unison prayer of invocation. God, whose goodness and grace rolled the stone away from the tomb and raised our Lord to everlasting life, we praise you for that glorious miracle. Because our Savior lives, we know that you are always with us to scatter the shadows of death and despair. You are always there to bring joy out of sorrow and to give us the strength and the wisdom that we need for the living of these days. So we ask you again, Holy One, to come to us in the power of your resurrection love, that we may hold fast to the truth and the peace that is always waiting for us in the risen Christ, who taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Was in the beginning, is now and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
Please be seated. As we gather this day with joy in our hearts, it is because we know that the tomb was empty, and because of that we have a life that is abundant and the promise of a life that shall be everlasting. So let us give thanks as we come now to God's altar with our tithes and our offerings.
Thank you.
Please join me in the prayer of dedication. God of this life and the life that is to be, we give you thanks and praise for the miracle of the empty tomb that even now fills our hearts with the joy and hope that we need in these turbulent times. As we continue to celebrate the good news with our jubilant alleluias, we also bring you our tithes and offerings. May our faithful giving and living be acceptable in your sight, for we ask it in the name of the Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit as one God forever and ever. Amen. Yes, I'd like to invite all the boys and girls to join me. It's always good to see you on a Sunday morning. It certainly brightens my day up. Even though it isn't sunny out, it's bright in here. And I have a question. Anybody have a birthday that's coming up? Okay, when's your birthday?
May 19th.
May 19th, also a little bit, not that far away, yep.
May
7th? Okay, so I'm gonna guess you're gonna have birthday parties. And you're gonna hope people bring you presents, right? Yep. And before you can go to a birthday party, what do you have to get first? That's right, an invitation, very good. And you can't just show up at a birthday party uninvited, can you? We got a picture up here of a birthday party, and let's see, some other things that you need an invitation to go to. How about a graduation? You need a graduation invitation, and let me see, I'm trying to remember what the next one is. I think Thanksgiving. Yep, I got that one right. And you don't do formal invitations, but I have Thanksgiving at the parsonage every year, and so I call up all of my relatives and I invite them. And let me see, oh, every once in a while, people need an invitation to come to something here in the sanctuary. Any guesses what it might be? A wedding. Need an invitation to go to wedding. You don't want to be a wedding crasher. And sometimes people have parties after a baptism, and you need an invitation for that as well. So all kinds of events and celebrations where you need an invitation. And you know who's waiting for an invitation from you? Jesus. See, Jesus wants to be a part of your life and my life, but he will only come in and share our lives when we invite him, and we keep inviting him. And that's a story that I really like in John's Gospel. And it's about two disciples. We only know one of them. His name was Cleopas. We don't know the name of the other one. And this is the day where Jesus rose from the dead, and they're going to a place called Emmaus. We have no idea where it is. We just know that it's 8 miles outside of Jerusalem. And as they're walking along the road, Jesus suddenly appeared to them. Only they didn't recognize him. And they talked with him, and he explained why Jesus had to suffer on the cross. Then when they got to Emmaus, Jesus was going to keep walking, and that's where they were going to stop. But they invited him to stay with them. And when they sat down, they began to have a meal, and Jesus broke the bread. And suddenly, they realized who it was. And his appearance was suddenly gone. He vanished from their eyes, and they were so excited. They went running back to Jerusalem to tell everyone the good news. And that wouldn't have happened if they they hadn't invited him to stay with them. And so that's what we do when we come here. Every Sunday when we come here, we're saying again and again, Jesus, I want you to be a part of my life. I'm going to invite you to be a part of my life. And we also do that when we spend time and we pray and when we read the scriptures. And when we invite him into our life, it will always be better, just as it was better for those disciples when they saw him and went running back to Jerusalem with so much joy in their hearts. And I believe that Dorothy is going to do our prayer this morning, so I'm going to invite you to come up. Sit right here. All right.
Dear God.
What?
Dear God, we thank you for Jesus and all that he has done for us, helping us to invite him to be part of our lives by praying and reading the stories about him in the Bible and coming here to praise him. This we ask so that we can be like him. Amen.
Thank you. Savior, and nailed him to a tree. They crucified my Savior and nailed him to a tree. They crucified my Please be seated. Please join me in the responsive call to prayer. Draw near to God, and God will draw near to you.
Let us lift up our hearts to the Lord.
Good people, let us enter into this time of stillness that we might be one with our God. Sisters and brothers, are there prayers that you would like to lift up to the Lord this day? Yes, David.
My friend Sarita became a brand new grandmother of a daddy in Hindi a week ago. She has a brand new granddaughter named Maya.
So we give thanks for the Maya's birth and ask God's blessing upon her and her family and her grandmother. Lord, in your goodness. Yes, Meredith.
I went to visit Barbara Tufts this week.
Oh, wonderful.
She is wonderful. Oh. My heart is filled with joy because she is so well and so happy in her new home.
Yes, so she recently went to Brightview in North Andover, and she has been living with Parkinson's for a number of years now, but her whole attitude and her faith is very uplifting, so I know exactly what you're saying when your heart was full of joy. And we ask God's blessing upon our good sister, Barbara Tufts. Lord, in your goodness. I also lift up in prayer Roy Walters, and I learned this past week that he had a fall and broke a bone in his foot, and he is wearing a boot now. We ask God's healing for him. Lord, in your goodness. Also received some good news. As many of you know, Kevin and Linda Welch's daughter, Kelly, has been dealing with the after effects of a very serious stroke a couple of years ago, and learned that she is now going to be transitioning to an apartment, so more of an independent living, and so we give thanks to God for that. Lord, in your goodness. We lift up Brenda Lane, who will be having knee surgery on Tuesday. We ask that God's healing be upon her. Lord, in your goodness. Also, we received word that Robin Johns, former member here, now living in Virginia for about the last 8 years, her father, Albert Williams, passed away. He was 100 years old. There will be a service celebrating his life here at Union Congregational Church in May. We ask God to be with Robin's family and also the family of Edna Smith. Lord, in your goodness. Let us pray. God of grace and everlasting glory, we give you thanks for this day, and that you are the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end of all things, and that you are here with us even now. We feel your Spirit with us, and we pray that we may be open to wherever it may lead us, wherever it may guide us, both as a community of faith, but also as individual disciples of the risen Christ. Holy One, we know that because the tomb is empty, that you can do all good things, and that you long for us to live our faith and to proclaim the good news in word and deed, that we bring the hope and the peace, the joy and the truth into the darkness of the world around us, and that we do that humbly with love in our hearts. And all this we pray in the name of our risen Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Our scripture reading this morning comes to us from Luke's Gospel, the 24th chapter, beginning with the 13th verse. We hear the story of the appearance of the risen Christ to the two disciples on the road to Emmaus. This happened late in the afternoon into the early evening of Easter Sunday. That very day, two of them were going to a village named Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. And they were talking with each other about all these things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing together, Jesus himself drew near and went with them. But their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, "What is this conversation that you are holding with each other as you walk?" And they stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, named Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only visitor to Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened there in these days?" And Jesus said to them, "What things?" And they said to him, "Concerning Jesus of Nazareth, a man who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and rulers delivered him up to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things happened. Moreover, some women of our company amazed us. They were at the tomb early in the morning, and when they did not find his body, they came back saying that they had even seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women said, but him they did not see. And he said to them, 'O foolish ones and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets had spoken. Was it not necessary that the Christ should suffer these things and enter into his glory?' And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. So they drew near to the village to which they were going. He acted as though he was going farther, but they urged him strongly, saying, 'Stay with us, for it is toward evening, and the day is now far spent.' So he went in to stay with them. When he was at table with them, he took the bread and blessed and broke it and gave it to them. And their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, 'Did not our hearts burn within us while he talked to us on the road, while he opened to us the scriptures?' And they rose that same hour and returned to Jerusalem. And they found the 11 and those who were with them gathered together, saying, 'The Lord has risen indeed and has appeared to Simon.' Then they told what had happened on the road and how he was known to them in the breaking of the bread." Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts upon the sacred scriptures be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and always our Redeemer. Amen. It's hard sometimes not to get discouraged, isn't it? That's what an elderly man thought one Saturday morning when he got up early and went for a walk. The walk eventually took him to a park where he stopped to watch a Little League baseball game. As he was standing there watching the game, he asked a youngster sitting on the end of the bench a question. "What's the score?" the elderly man said. 23-0, the youth replied. "Oh my," the elderly man said. "Well, don't get discouraged. After all, it isn't whether you win or lose. It's how you play the game." At that point, the youngster looked at the elderly man like he had lobsters crawling out of his ears. "Why would I be discouraged?" the youngster said. "It's only the top of the first. We even had our turn to bat yet." Well, you have to give that youngster credit for his optimism. With everything that's going on these days, it's hard not to get a little discouraged. If the economy doesn't keep you awake at night, just look at all the mass shootings that we're seeing. On March 27th, 6 students and teachers were shot and killed at the Covenant School in Nashville, Tennessee. On April 10th, 5 people were shot and killed at the Old National Bank in Louisville, Kentucky. On April 15th, four people were shot and killed at a not-so-sweet 16th birthday party in Dadeville, Alabama. And just this past Tuesday, four people were shot and killed at a house up in Bowdoin, Maine. Or how about the senseless hate crime that occurred last Sunday that almost took the life of a 16-year-old teenager by the name of Ralph Jarl. He's the black teenager out in Kansas City who was shot and almost killed when he went to the wrong house to pick up his younger twin brothers. Yes, all of the violence and all the hate crimes, all of the greed and the sinful selfishness, it's enough to leave you feeling discouraged at times. That's why it probably won't come as a big surprise that according to a poll that was conducted the end of January, 71% of the people in this country believe that we're heading in the wrong direction. 71%. What do you think? Are we heading in the wrong direction? If your answer to that question is yes, I'm right there with you. With everything that's going on, it's hard at times not to feel a little discouraged. But remember, with the risen Christ, there is always hope. And that brings us to those two disciples and what happened to them while they were on the road to Emmaus. You see, good people, Emmaus is the key to the things that dismay us. So let's start by looking at how those two disciples were feeling as they made their way to Emmaus. Interestingly enough, they were feeling the same way a lot of us are feeling these days. They were discouraged. They were discouraged because the cross made it abundantly clear to them that Jesus wasn't going to be the conquering hero they wanted. They were discouraged because the crucifixion made it abundantly clear to them that Jesus wasn't the Messiah who was going to lead them to victory over the Romans. Yes, they were discouraged like many of us today. But then everything changed. It changed when they sat down with the risen Christ and broke bread together. In that grace-filled moment, their eyes were suddenly opened. And then the risen Christ vanished from their sight. He was quickly gone. And just as quickly, those two disciples were on their way back to Jerusalem in the middle of the night. Only now, instead of being down in the dumps and discouraged, they were walking on air and greatly encouraged. Instead of being full of sadness, they were now full of gladness. Do you remember what they said when the risen Christ vanished from their sight? They said to each other, "Did not our hearts burn within us while he talked to us on the road?" Good people, make no mistake about it, that burning sensation wasn't acid reflux. It was the miracle of the risen Christ. The miracle of the risen Christ turned things around for those two disciples, and it is the miracle of the risen Christ that can and will turn things around for us. So let us faithfully and fearlessly follow him back to Jerusalem, where he's waiting for us with his truth and his wisdom, his grace and his peace, his courage and his compassion. Things will turn around when we follow him. We're not going to turn things around by following the backbiting and backstabbing politicians who think they know what's best because they have a lot of power. We're not going to turn things around by following the billionaires and the CEOs who think they know what's best because they have lots of money. We're not going to turn things around by following the talking heads on CNN and Fox who think they know what's best because a lot of people watch them every night. No, the only way things are going to turn around is when we faithfully and fearlessly follow the risen Christ and encourage others to faithfully and fearlessly follow him. Right now, the risen Christ is waiting for us in Jerusalem. The risen Christ who embraced people who were different. The risen Christ who shared God's love with foreigners like that woman at the Samaritan well. And people who were despised like Zacchaeus, the tax collector. And prostitutes like Mary Magdalene. And lepers and sinners. And sweaty, smelly fishermen like Peter and Andrew, James and John. Let us faithfully and fearlessly follow the risen Christ who practices his own form of liberty and justice for all when he drove the money changers out of the temple. Why? Because they were cheating poor people out of the little money that they had. Let us faithfully follow the risen Christ who made it very clear that you won't find happiness, you won't find joy in the things you own. You'll only find it in the people you love and the people who love you. The risen Christ, who in the Sermon on the Mount said, "Do not lay up treasures for yourself here on earth where moth and rust destroy and thieves break in and steal, but rather store up for yourself treasures in heaven where moth and rust do not destroy and thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." Yes, Emmaus is the key for the things that dismay us. That's basically the conclusion that the French philosopher Alex de Tocqueville came to back in 1833. He came to this country to find out what makes us tick. And he wrote his conclusions in a little essay called The Greatness and Genius of America. It's possible that he didn't write the last two lines of that essay, but those two lines definitely fit with everything else that he wrote in the essay. It goes like this. "I searched for the greatness and genius of America in her commodious harbors and her ample rivers, and it was not there. I searched for the greatness and genius of America in her fertile fields and her boundless forests, and it was not there. I searched for the greatness and genius of America in her rich mines and her vast world commerce, and it was not there. I searched for the greatness and genius of America in her public school system and institutions of higher learning, and it was not there. I searched for the greatness and genius of America in her democratic Congress and her matchless Constitution, and it was not there. Not until I went into the churches of America and heard her pulpits flame with righteousness did I discover the secret of America's genius and greatness. America is great because America is good. And if America ever ceases to be good, she will cease to be great." Good people, it's true. We can't do everything. But never underestimate what the risen Christ can do through you and me and all of us together when we faithfully and fearlessly follow him. Amen. people of God, our service of worship has over. Let us prepare to go forth wherever we may be to continue our service of love, knowing that our God goes before us. And may the blessing of God Almighty, Creator Christ and Holy Spirit, be upon you all. Amen.